In the previous tutorial, we learned the basics of utilizing NGINX rate limiting. Generally, rate limiting is put in place as a defensive measure for services. Now, one of the most common use cases for rate limiting is to block brute force attacks. In a brute force attack, a hacker usually automates sending an endless amount of requests to maybe an endpoint or potentially to, in this case, a web form. So here we have a hacker which is launching a brute force attack on your Django admin login webpage. Their program will be automated to automatically add a username and password in the form, in the admin form, and then submit it. And that can be done 10, 100,000 times per second until eventually a match is found. This type of attack is very easy to detect, but potentially they are not so easy to prevent. So if we just think about some different strategies for this type of attack, maybe we block the IP address. Well, that potentially doesn't work because the attacker might be utilizing multiple IP addresses. Secondly, you may have experienced this, after maybe incorrectly typing in a password a few different times, your account becomes locked out, maybe for a certain amount of time. So this isn't always the best solution because this can be abused. Anyone could make a bot potentially to identify maybe a login. As soon as they know what the login is, they can send lots of information to try and log in, and eventually that account will then obviously get blocked for a certain amount of time, and that can be very frustrating. So that type of way of working whereby the account is simply locked out after a number of different incorrect password attempts might not be the best approach in your case. So locking out accounts after a defined number of incorrect password attempts isn't necessarily going to be your approach, and this potentially is also because this might cause a denial of service because the attacker could potentially lock out a large number of accounts. So we have to think about some other different countermeasures. So in this tutorial, we're going to configure NGINX to limit the amount of HTTP requests a user can make to the Django admin login page. So you will find a link in the video description if you want to follow this along step by step. That would take you to the GitHub repository for this tutorial series. And you just need to download part 8 here, the code. That's going to be our base code that we're going to start from. In addition to that, you are going to need Docker Desktop installed if you want to follow this along step by step. So go ahead, open up part 8 in Visual Studio Code. And then the first thing that we're going to need to do, which is really annoying, and I keep forgetting to do this, is we just need to create a new folder, a .env, an environment folder, just to get things working. And a new file inside of here, we're going to need to call that dev.env. I keep forgetting to update this. And then just go ahead and create a new file here. This can be absolutely anything. Localhost, give that a go, and debug one. Okay, so that's just some environment variables that we're going to need to start Django. So assuming you do have Docker Desktop installed, it is available for Mac, Windows, and Linux now. So have that open, and then we'll just go ahead and we'll get this started. So we have a Docker Compose file. So we just need to run Docker Compose up. That will build the images and start the containers. So if you go over to your browser, just type in the local loopback address. It should work without the port, so you shouldn't need any ports here. And then you can see we have some endpoints. So just see what that is. Okay. And then let's go over to the admin. Should work okay. Admin, yep. Okay, so this is the Django admin page. If we take a look at the URL, you can see that the admin form here is hosted at admin/login. The default Django setup is that we can type in a username and password pretty much as many times as you like. Now, there are some different plugins, extensions that you can install, which will help you protect this a little bit further. Maybe you do want to set up some sort of delayed approach so that if someone does type in their username and password a few different times, it will then lock them out for a couple of minutes. Maybe that is the approach you want to take. However, in this tutorial, we're going to be talking about rate limiting. And what that essentially means here for the Django administration login page is we're going to limit the amount of times someone can actually click on this login button. So what happens when someone clicks on this login button, the page essentially refreshes and the information gets sent to this page. So behind the scenes, we're capturing that post request, and Django is then taking the username and password and then trying to actually then log in. So if we can limit the amount of times someone can send a message, a request to admin/login, essentially we can limit the amount of time a bot or an attacker can actually press this login button or actually send information to this endpoint. So let's head back into the default configuration here in Nginx default config. So this is a configuration that we ended in the previous tutorial, and we're just going to work from here. It'd be well worth going to the previous tutorial, having a look at that. If I haven't already mentioned, you just need to look for the playlist on the main site and then go to the Nginx Mastery playlist. And the tutorial you're looking for, the previous tutorial was Nginx rate limiting Docker. So that was the previous tutorial. Check that out first, maybe, and then come back to this tutorial if you need some more information. If we take a look at the current setup here, we have the limit request zone set up for the IP address. So we're going to capture the user's IP address that's making the request, and we're going to utilize that to check it against the rate. Now, at the moment, we've set this to 1RS, which is essentially just one request per second. And we probably need to change that shortly. And then if the user does go beyond that and get rate limited, then they're going to return the 429 HTTP error. So with that in place, we then apply the rate limiting down here. So we define our zone, and then we go ahead and we've set two settings here. Again, this is from the previous tutorial. So we've defined burst and delay. I'll explain that again shortly, but that's the current setup. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a new location for defining the admin location. So location. And then we just need to define the admin/login. So that's our endpoint. And now we go ahead, we're just going to move this into our location block. Let's just finish this off. Okay, so we're going to move that into our location block. So this is just really the reference, isn't it, to our limit request zone that we've defined up here. That's our zone. So at the moment, let's just get rid of the burst and delay. So we're just going to go for that zone. So with that in place, let's just go ahead and just add all the other information so we get this working. Okay, so with that in place, I've got the Docker extension here so I can access my containers very easily from Visual Studio Code. So that's the extension Docker. And then I can just go ahead and restart my container. So you can just do this in Docker Desktop, of course. Just restart the container. So that will then apply the new settings. Let's go over and have a look. So let's just try and log in. So press login and press login again and again. And you can see I try to do that quite quickly. And eventually you can see that I've done it too many times and I get the 429 HTTP error. If you're not too familiar with status codes, HTTP response status codes, it's well worth just a refreshing yourself on that. So this is a 429. So if I go to 429, you can see that is designed for the too many requests. A user has sent too many requests in a given amount of time. So rate limiting. So you can change that. Of course, in our code, we've set that manually. So maybe you want to return something else. So you did see how quickly I had to actually try and press these buttons before I actually got the rate limiting to come into effect. So this admin site isn't generally utilized by customers. It's generally used by the smaller amount of administrators you might have. So setting the rate limiting to one request per second actually would probably work okay in this instance, because you saw how, like I said before, you saw how quickly you have to actually type in the username and password before you receive the rate limiting error. There we go. So there we have it. Potentially, we've just set up a very simple security measure that you might want to apply on your admin login. So just a quick reminder about burst and delay. I mentioned it previously. I'd mention this again. I did explain it in the previous tutorial, but for anyone who needs it. So burst. So at the moment, we've set this as one request per second. So burst is going to provide us, if you like, a little bit of memory space. So in actual fact, if someone were to make 11 requests per second, for example, then what's going to happen is the first request will get processed and the next 10 requests will get stored. Anything over that, that will get rejected and you would receive the response, the error response. Now, the delay here, what's happening here is that what's going to happen here is that the first request gets processed, the next 10 will get saved, and then there's two ways of handling this burst. Okay, so what could happen is the server could process the first request and then the next 10 straight away. Or, for example, we could limit this so that the first request is processed and then based upon the rate processing here, every second it will then process those 10 extra. Now, delay is basically setting up how many of those burst will get processed instantly and then how many of them will then get delayed over a certain amount of time and get processed over that certain amount of time. So what's happening here then is the first item, imagine we send 11 requests. So the first item, bam, is getting processed. The next 10 is getting saved. Now, out of those 10 that will get saved, the first 5 of those will be processed instantly and the rest will then get delayed. So that's burst and delay. So hopefully that's going to be useful for someone. It's well worth just adding. If you're someone who's setting up a basic Django web page and you're using the Django admin page and you haven't changed the URL or added any other security, and you then go and deploy your application, and you're probably going to deploy that somewhere that's going to need you to set up Nginx, it's not going to take too much more time for you to simply apply that setting. And that's just going to give you that extra potential, a little bit of protection on your Django admin web page. Hopefully that was useful. Thank you very much for listening, and I'll see you in the next tutorial.